episode of Millennial in the Middle. I'm Connor Dehlin. Today we have a fun episode and what turned out to be a very insightful interview. So I hope you enjoy this. I'm going to introduce you to Hunter Saunders. I actually got connected with Hunter Saunders just in the last couple months. He reached out to me on LinkedIn, of all things, and saw what was happening at Opt and the company we're building, and basically threw himself out there and said, I want to be a part of this. I want to jump in and talk through his skills in, marketing and brand creation and in social media and content. And I was like, all right, come on in. And I was so impressed immediately with his ability to learn quickly, to work hard, and to have some new ways of thinking that were really, really refreshing. Hunter is 23 years old, and he is the personification of like all things Gen Z. I know I talk about Gen Z a lot, and as I've gotten to know him, I'm like, man, you are the living, walking, example of Gen Z. You know, he dropped out of college and just jumped right into the workforce. Super smart, very passionate, and just excited to like get into the real world and find his own path. And as we put out a lot of content, if you followed me on social media, you've seen the values series that we put out, about 15 reels on Instagram and TikTok about kind of how our values have evolved. And we've also done some things along the line of generational theory. He's been really instrumental in helping with that. And we said, you know what, we've had all these great conversations in the office, let's do it in the podcast studio. So that's what we did today. I hope you enjoy this. I think you're going to find there's a depth to him and his answers that hopefully help you become a better parent, a better child, a better employee, whatever it might be. I think there are some things here that you really can take away. Enjoy. Hunter, I'm excited for this episode.
I'm pretty excited too.
We're going to take all these conversations that we've had of us just pontificating about the questions of the world.
Pontificating, that's a good word.
Oh, we're coming right out of the gates with
sorry,
a big word.
Sorry, Gen Z. Yeah, you're not invited.
Hey, you can't be the first one to say Gen Z in this interview. That's my thing. All right, I'm excited to talk through this because, like I said in the intro, you to me are the personification of Gen Z in so many ways. And in the last few months, as I've gotten to know you, but more importantly, see the way you think, what matters to you, I feel like I've learned a lot, and I hope that we can share that with the listeners today and have a little fun along the way. So, Hunter, thanks for being willing to do it.
I'm excited. I really am. So
good. Well, let's start with this. Just why don't you give people a little background of like your upbringing, where you're from, and you're 23 years old, right?
Yeah.
And so now you're working with me at Opt, and you're like all things marketing specialist. And I kind of resonated with the way that you reached out to me. It was like you saw an opportunity, you reached out, and after some conversations, it was like, we can make a spot for you, right? So give me a little bit about your background and what got you here.
Yeah, I moved 15 times. I think that is the biggest factor to who I am today.
Wow.
I've lived in Mexico City. I've lived in Columbia, Maryland. We've lived here in Utah. We've lived in Illinois. A lot of different parts, and that taught me how to adapt. That taught me that, like, no matter what your situation is, you can make the most out of it. I think that's the biggest thing, honestly, that either makes or breaks somebody in society today.
Yeah, that's really interesting that you say that had such a role in your development. What do you think about moving around so much? Like, what character traits did it instill in you that you think today?
Well, I can tell you what it didn't at first. Like, I was horrible with long-term relationships. Like, bless my freaking wife, because that chick has gone through a lot. I have like, you hear daddy issues and like mommy issues and stuff. Like, I had all types of issues. Honestly, it's freaking hard to, when you move every 6 months to a year to 2 years.
Yeah.
It's hard to realize who do you invest your time in? Like, who's your real friends? Who are the people that actually love you and want to be around you? I just tried to please everyone.
Yeah.
I was an entertainer. I was someone who changed according to who I was around.
Yeah.
And that bothered me.
Yeah.
When I met my wife, she was as stuck in her ways as anybody. And it made me see that I can be comfortable in who I am, that I can continue to grow and not change my values, not change who I am, not change my morals. And I think that's what I learned from this. That was the most impact. It was hard, yes, but it made it to where it's like, okay, well, now I have this this growth that has made me able to learn and to be adaptable and to honestly to see a lot of different people. I've been friends with every type of person, and yet I haven't had these deep relationships until recently.
Yeah. I can relate to that. I think that's really cool. I mean, and you said that about an entertainer, like that's in my blood as well. And it's really hard not to, you know, just always be in the mode of reading the room and being the person that, you know, people want you to be and finding what you like, what you care about, what's authentic to you, and then, you know, seeking out, and honestly, you don't even really have to seek them out. Like, people that are similar will be attracted to you.
Yeah.
And it's cool to see that kind of come to fruition in your life. So I want to come back to more of kind of the values, and we'll discuss that in a bit. But tell me about, like, what hobbies and interests did you have that all of a sudden led you to, you're kind of a jack of all trades. You're good at figuring stuff out. Like, tell us a little about that.
Yeah, I pride myself in being, like, I'm average at a lot of things, but I'm not extremely talented in a specific thing. And that bothers me sometimes. I'm not going to lie.
Yeah.
But at the same time, my ability to learn new things, it's driven me into who I am today and to where I'm a jack of all trades. I don't say that. I just say that I can learn and pick up stuff quickly.
Yeah.
And I remember it. And then I put some emotion behind it, whether it's frustration, whether it's, you know, whatever, and then it becomes a long-term memory.
Yeah.
That's something we heard at Silicon Slopes with Jim Quick, is once you have information combined with emotion, that makes a long-term memory. And that's kind of, I didn't realize I was doing that until we went to Silicon Slopes, but that kind of impacted me. That kind of directed me.
And just a curiosity. I mean, that's been something that I've been really impressed with the last couple months working with you, of all of a sudden it's like, oh, I thought this is what you were good at, but you're good at that too. So, you know, all of a sudden when you're good at stuff, you're going to be asked to do things and, you know, being willing to step up and put yourself in the spotlight there. You've only been in the workforce for like 2 years. So like, what has that experience been like? I mean, this is a Gen Zer that has never experienced before he comes to working in an office.
Yeah.
Like, he's like, this is so excited. Can I bring a plant and put it on my desk? I'm like, sure, you can do whatever you want, right?
I know.
Where that's just, it's funny that I think we would take that so for granted. And here you were thinking this was cool that you got to get up in the morning, take a shower, get dressed and go to work.
I think it's common among Gen Z. It's like my first office job, my first big boy job.
Yeah,
that's what Gen Z sees. It's like they'll have these like temporary, these side hustles, these remote jobs, but it just doesn't feel like a job until it's real. Like, until you have a building or you have your own office and have the corner office, whatever it may be, you're like, holy shiz, I made it. Like, this is what all the TV shows do. Like, I grew up watching The Office and I'm like, I'm Jim, I'm him. You know what I mean? Like,
oh, the glamorous life of being a paper salesman in Scranton, Pennsylvania.
Exactly. Yeah. Well, yeah. And so that kind of was like, it fulfilled what my grandparents and parents have always said, you know, and it's kind of like an accomplishment that, like, I've been validated. I've been given a chance, and that's because of you, you know, obviously, being able to take that chance. But, you know, I've worked my butt off in those 2 years.
Yeah.
You know, I went, you know, Dev Mountain while I was doing tech job, while I was serving at PF Chang's for a year and a half.
Yeah.
And I learned so many things along the way. And I was like, I'm so freaking glad I didn't pay for this in college. Because now I'm getting a business degree from one of the best. And then, of course, our board members who are saying, hey, you need to do this for PR and, you know, our, you know, James and stuff like that.
We have a member of our board who's British. And I love that you just started doing his accent. Yeah. We love you, James, if you're listening.
Yeah. And I came to the realization that there are jobs out there, like being a doctor, being a lawyer. You need the information in that moment, mm-hmm. or else you will not make money. But think about a marketer or somebody who's in charge of operations, mm-hmm. somebody who's in charge of strategy, growth, whatever. They learn as they go.
Yeah.
They don't need to know everything. They try stuff. They A-B test. If it works, great. If not, then they try a different thing.
Yeah.
I'm not getting that in college. And that's kind of why I chose to drop out. I wasn't having failures. I wasn't learning. I didn't have any emotion behind this information that I was getting. So nothing was relevant to me. Hmm. Once I went into the workplace and I was getting paid to learn, that's how I saw it.
Yeah.
I went summer sales. I learned sales tactics. I learned nodding. I learned nonverbals, paraverbals. I learned how people are, reading people. And I learned that I can do hard things. And the hard things suck. Yeah. they really do. It's like, frick, I'm never doing that shiz again.
Yeah.
And then I learned the same thing when I got in that little pyramid scheme MLM. You know, I'm like, choice, freedom, let's go, you know. And I was so excited. And then I realized the reason I was excited is because I wanted freedom. I wanted choice. And I learned and was being paid to learn. And so I've kind of shifted my mentality of like, I love education and I never want to stop learning. Mm-hmm. I read books on the daily, you know, trying to build my brain, trying to build who mm-hmm. I am. But there comes a time where you just have to go out there and learn.
Yeah.
And why not just get paid to learn by yeah. learning Salesforce and getting paid to learn those stuff that you might learn in college or you might not.
I think that's some really good insights. I think in what you just said right there, there's some concepts, some philosophies at the root of that. And I think, you know, you talked about, I think the old school way of higher education or college is like, hey, everyone, here's the playbook. Here's the textbook. It's yeah. the same textbook we've looked at forever. It gets updated maybe once every 5 to 10 years. And it's more of just like, hey, we're going to test you on if you know what we know.
Yeah.
But what you just explained right there, and I loved that you said that about, no, like this new generation goes out and they will A-B test and find out what works and yeah. be willing to fail and try new things, realizing that there is no playbook.
Yeah.
That it's changing and evolving on the fly, and the ability to adapt, the ability to learn is so important. And, you know, when you talk specifically about higher education, I know you were there for a minute.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Like, did you feel there was a disconnect there?
Yeah. I mean, I talked to my wife. She's attending at UVU, a local college here in Utah. And she talks about there's this disconnect because we see the crazy stats you get on Monday Night Football that this guy had a 6.7 meter jump or whatever the stupid shiz that they come up with. And you're like, yeah, this is brought to you by IBM, you know, and it's like this technology that's crazy awesome. Where is that for schooling? Seriously, where are the next gen stats for schooling? Where are the next gen technology that is being implemented everywhere else but in the school place? My wife goes, pays $7,000, and then she gets to listen to some old guy talk about his life and what he's learned, and that is not valuing her time. Seriously, that's $7,000. I'm sure you can break it up. I'm not going to and embarrass myself in front of everyone, but yeah. It made me realize how outdated this stuff is. And I know they're trying to make a change, and I believe, and I already know when I'm a multimillionaire one day,
yeah,
I'm going to donate hugely because I want to change it.
Yeah.
I want to give it a better way. I want, you know, these teachers to get paid more.
Yeah.
But yeah, there's just that disconnect. in between, hey, the future's different. Let's teach you and lecture you about it. No, yeah. Let's freaking show you. Let's go out there. Like, that's what they need to be doing, in my opinion.
Yeah.
Is that exposure, that immersion is what increases learning.
Oh, man. There's so much that I can unwrap there. But I love as you talk through, like, I think we can all picture this person at the front of the room that is having a one-way conversation.
Yeah.
That's like, well, this is how it is, right? And make sure, you know, I have the power. I can do a pop quiz and make this at any time. What you explained there is more collaborative. It's more empowering. And it's more exciting. Like, it's more fun and engaged when that takes place that way. Now, I've talked about you being kind of the personification of Gen Z in a lot of ways. And I know when we talk a lot about this, like, obviously we're making assumptions and we're being broad and general swoops through it, but that's okay, right? Yeah. Like, let's do it. So I want to like do a little grill session for you here. Frick. I want to hear Gen Z, how do you feel your generation views baby boomers? Like, ooh. How do you think about boomers?
Yeah. I think I think a lot of us as Gen Z, including myself, we group it into two different types of boomers.
Okay, go on.
There is the ones that are kind of like woke.
Woke
yeah.
boomers. All right.
Yeah, the ones that were kind of like on the back end of Woodstock, all that stuff is usually what happens.
Yeah.
And they're aware of the changes, and they just love their grandkids the way they are. Hmm. I've been blessed to have two grandmas like that. That just love us the way we are. She doesn't care. I dropped out of college. She just cares that I'm happy.
Yeah.
She doesn't care that I don't have, you know, I didn't have a stable job right out of, you know, being 23 when everybody else was graduating. She just cares that I got married to an amazing wife. Hmm. So there's that side of the boomers. And then there's those who just don't give a flip about anything. They're just there. It's the opposite of self-aware. They know. It's almost like they might know that they're so different, but it's like this stubbornness, this like, I will not change at all. I am who I am. And that's good sometimes. It really is. But it also has its effects.
Yeah.
Where you feel like your grandparents are cold. Yeah, that's what I see, honestly.
That's interesting. I think there's a lot of truth to what you just said, those two groups. Like, you definitely do see the people that are, you know, progressive, woke, whatever you want to call it. But, like, the people that are the parents and grandparents that are cool and they want to learn and they want to be a part of that and want to empower them on the path that they're at. And then there's very much a mindset of, like, no, that's not the way. That's exactly. not how you do it. This is the rule book. Like, this is a fad. That's not going to happen. And frankly, that's always happened in our society, right? Yeah. Like, Elvis started gyrating his hips and everyone's like, what is this rock and roll devil music, right? And, you know, that's something that's so common for these older generations to look at a new trend or a new way of thinking and just be like, nope, mm-mm. not it. Why? Because that's not my experience and I'm not willing to relate and empathize.
Yeah. I agree. I think the core behind that, if we look at it, is that those grandparents that we see as awesome, that are cool, it's because they've never stopped learning.
Hmm.
They learn from their grandchildren and from their kids.
Yeah.
Versus those who are stubborn and say, I am the source of all knowledge and truth.
Yeah.
And that is just like a testament of why it's so important to never stop learning.
Yeah. Well, I think with learning too, that's just communication, right? The importance of making sure communication is two way.
Yeah.
And it's not two people giving monologues simultaneously, right? All right. So there's our boomer. We got to get through the speed round. Now I'm curious how you feel Gen Z looks at Gen X, the forgotten, middle, unidentified generation.
Honestly, I think most Gen Z are unaware that there's a Gen X. They're like, wait, what? They're like, who? Okay. Because they honestly just assume that their parents are boomers. That's honestly, they don't see a separation. So I think they oftentimes get a bad rap. They're the ones on TikTok that are like, you'll see a comment like, somebody come get their dad, and the dad's like doing something super cringe or like dressing up as a girl and is doing like some TikTok dance, and you're like, Bro, that is, like, my dad makes me cringe every day. Like, he does these dancing videos, all this stuff, and it just is like, I love you. I get it that you're trying.
But stop.
But stop. Yeah, no, literally. And so I'm like, and I think that kind of goes with Gen X, is like,
yeah,
they want to try. They want to be there with their kids. Yeah. And that's powerful. I really do think that's going to pay dividends once we've matured. Yeah. But right now we're just teenagers and 20-year-olds who are, you know, here how they were raised and how they had to walk to school and stuff like that. Same with the boomers. And it's like, okay, well, we have different struggles. And that's where the disconnect is.
I love that. So well put. All right. Now we're going down the line. Yeah. Millennials.
Oh, Frank.
This is me, that's right? You, man. I'm that millennial right in the middle.
Let's turn this into a roast session.
You know, no. I will. You have the mic. Go ahead.
So here's the thing. What I see with like millennials is there's a very big similarity between Gen Z and millennials. They are more worried about, when you talk about Maslow's hierarchy of needs, they're worried about the top level self-actualization. Mm-hmm. But I think they talk, because they're older, they talk a lot more about like mental health and politics and more involved in that than Gen Z is. We just want to be like, what's the meme behind it? You know what I mean? Like, what's the stuff that's going to make me laugh? Listening,
that's meme, M-E-M-E, not the memeing of life.
Yeah, no. And so I think there's like a disconnect where I honestly feel like I'm looked down a lot of the times, like by millennials, like, oh, you're so childish.
Huh.
And ultimately it's like, yeah, maybe. But at the same time, I'm not dealing with the same exact things. I don't have Rugrats, except it's stupid. I mean, have you guys seen the new Rugrats?
No.
It's like this 3D horrible. Me and my wife look at each other and we're like, this is whack. So it's just like there's things that have been like new and improved, and then there's things that millennials have. I almost think it's like an ownership thing. Like, we have this, millennials have this, and then Gen Z owns this type of stuff. And that's where the separation comes from.
Interesting. No, I think through this, as I've learned, I've been kind of surprised that you and I are, you know, 7-8 years apart.
Yeah.
And I'm like, man, you really do think different. And especially your experience with technology and social media, digital marketing, it's different than me just because of, you know, what I had access to in my coming of age years.
Yeah.
I know I've talked about this on the show before, but for me, like, I didn't have Instagram in high school, right? Like, I had Instagram in, you know, in the middle of college is when all of a sudden that was coming out for me. And I remember, like, early on in my high school years getting Facebook, but it wasn't the constancy. It wasn't the everything had to be perfect or how many followers you had. That wasn't a part of my upbringing. And then all of a sudden to have this shift immediately to where, like, the next group of classmen that were, you know, 4 years younger than me taking my spot at high school, all of a sudden, social media was a piece of this, and now you add on top of that TikTok. Like, how much of an influence do you think that has played in your life and creates that difference between us being just 7-8 years apart?
I mean, I think we're a lot more aware of people's feelings because of technology and because of social media.
Interesting.
We are now globally connected to teens around the world. Instantly, we can send a message or get on Omegle and say, what's up, whatever it may be. And we can instantly be connected to people around the world and see, hey, what's going on over there?
Yeah.
And it makes this thing where it's no longer just America. You know, it's not just the youth in America. It's the youth around the world. And it's become this huge, huge body that's just a common trend around the world, not just in America, which is very different. I really do think, like, that now we're all connected. We've really added our numbers.
Yeah. I love that you said that. I've talked about this on the show, of the ability to connect is unparalleled. And there's no real such thing as borders anymore. I mean, if we were to compare that, I think I've said this on the show before, but if you were to take someone that, you know, was a baby boomer as a child, you know, a baby boomer, so a child in the 50s, 60s, whatever it might be, their circle of influence and the information that they would have access to was tied to their family, their neighbors, those that they would see in school and their teachers, and then maybe what they heard on the radio or watched on the nightly news, yeah, read in the newspaper, and that was about it. But now the amount of information that you can get access to, which obviously has its pros and its cons, but it does lead to this group of people in the information age that I think, because there's more to conceptualize and break down and think through, it puts more of the onus on these generations to figure out, well, what do I think?
Yeah.
I know that I can find people that will say the exact opposite thing about almost any topic out there. So what do I feel?
Yeah. Yeah. I think that comes from a change in value. My parents say go to school. Mm-hmm. My grandparents said go to school. That was the plan. That was the playbook. That's because they were insured and said, if you go to school, you'll have a stable, solid job. You'll be able to buy a house within 5 years. You'll be able to get retirement, and everything will be good. It's like that white picket fence,
sure,
dream. That's
the American, not the American dream anymore.
No, it's not. Not at all. The dream is I have ownership, and I did this on my own. Hmm. That this is my path that I have created for myself. And I think there's so much power in that. I mean, it's just like, and that's why we kind of built off to empower.
Yeah.
To say, yes, freaking do it, man.
Yeah.
Do it, bro. Like, yes, go out and get it.
Yeah. And I love you just used the word path right there. And I think it's a recognition too, that there is not the path,
yeah,
right? It's not just like, oh, here's the one way and this is the formula for success. So just plug yourself into it. That there, part of that success metric is feeling like you had some self-determination there,
yeah,
that you had choice, that you had the ability to decide what mattered to you and what didn't, and then went out and lived your life in an authentic way because of what you came to. I think that potentially, if that mindset can become commonplace, it'll lead to, if you, just like people that are more evolved and open and understanding and hopefully better in the way, you know, that we, yeah, feel about ourselves and then the way we connect with others. Is that what you see happening?
Yeah. I mean, I love how you say that, like, we've evolved and we've become more real. I think Gen Z has been gifted with what I call authenticity sniffers.
Hmm.
And what I mean by that is they literally can tell who's being authentic and who isn't.
Mm-hmm.
Now, the way that connects is because you want to be authentic to your own brand. You want to be real, and people can see when you're being real and when you're not. But if you can build a business or a brand or whatever it may be around you, think of how much confidence. And then I go on to the other side, like, will that ruin people's confidence? And I think it does. And that's the danger of social media. That's the danger of all of those things, is that if it doesn't succeed, then it's like, you know,
yeah,
it's like, I'm not good enough.
Yeah.
And for all of you out there, like, I want to say, like, absolutely. I've felt like that so many times. I mean, I have so many things that I am uncomfortable in and not confident about, but like, I promise there is a way.
Yeah.
And there always will be. It's sometimes you just got to change paths.
Yeah.
You just got to have that courage, and you got to have somebody in your life and to kind of encourage you or empower you to do that.
Sure. I love that. I want to talk more specifically about you. I think you, in a lot of ways, present a good model to follow for your generation of go be obsessed with learning, mm-hmm, and mastering a craft or honing in different skills that you enjoy, like seeing the results of producing that, right? Yeah. And then when you feel like you're at a place of just a little bit of competence, right? Yeah. Make a move and surround yourself with people that can continue to help you on that path. And so I'm curious, with that mindset, explain to me your thought process of like, reaching out to me on LinkedIn and saying, hey, I like what you're doing here. Like, this is cool. And, you know, I didn't respond to you right away. Like, there's also a side to, like, when I can see people are determined and they're going to hit me up several times, it's like, oh, okay, this guy's serious. Like, I'll give this an ear. What was your thought process that kind of led to that?
I think one of the biggest lessons that my dad taught me is to never be afraid to take that step, to always have courage. I mean, he changed jobs a lot, and I saw that as courageous, not as a loser like some society would say. I look up to him because he was willing to say, I don't want to compromise my happiness for this job. And that made me realize that, like, if I take that chance, if I put myself out there, I might get rejected. Yeah, it might suck for a sec. But I have so many other people to hit up. I have so many others. And that kind of comes from, like, that abundance mindset that we've talked about before. There's millions of users on LinkedIn. I know my skills, and I believe in my way. So if this is meant to be, then it will happen. And that's what I've always believed, and that's what I'll always believe in, is that, like, I know who I am now. I know I'm good at learning. And I think one of the biggest things that I didn't realize is you have to add value. But the best way to figure out if you're adding value is, for example, you're a visionary. You're able to say, I'm starting a business tomorrow. I'm starting a podcast right now in 2020. Mm-hmm. I've always wanted to, but I've looked up every single way to do it. I have all the processes. I could start a podcast right now if I wanted to, but I didn't have somebody to empower me or to say, do that.
Yeah.
And that's where the power comes from. That's where the value, because now I can say, this is how you do this. And that's where, you know, you fall short sometimes. It's like, okay, where's the operation part of this?
Sure.
And if you can fit in, if you can either provide visionary, if you're one who starts, you know, companies at the age of 15 and has his own brand or whatever, you're oftentimes like a visionary. Mm-hmm. And I appreciate Tyler, who's going to have me on one of his podcasts here soon. Mm-hmm. He talked about that. It's like he just needed somebody to empower him just enough. So find yourself.
Yeah.
That person. It's hard.
Yeah.
But when you put yourself out there, and you'll know.
Yeah.
When you find them.
I love that. A couple things I want to point out. One, be the person that empowers others, right? Yeah. Like, there's an opportunity. You're in a role to empower others as well. And I think, you know, you mentioned abundance mentality. I think there's so much success to go around out there, more than ever.
Yeah.
And so, you know, if you are concerned with helping other people win, you can't help but win yourself along the way, right? And so I, you know, I wanted to just make that statement about be the one to empower, an empowerer.
Yeah.
But then I love what you said about, to me, what I heard was overcoming fear, because our biggest fear that many of us have is failure, that we're going to lose, that it's not going to work out. Everyone's going to say we were crazy or dumb, and that we just had no idea what we were doing. But when you said there's other options out there if this doesn't work. And I think with the information that we have out there now, it kind of takes a little bit of the burden off that it's like, look, no decision you make in your life is permanent. You know, like, be willing to try stuff. If it doesn't work, great. What did you learn from that bit? And how can you roll that into the next hopeful win? And I think that's a really, really cool mentality of, like, you're not necessarily picking your destiny for the next 25 years and let's just sure hope that you do it right.
Yeah.
Like, go make moves and see what happens and see where your individual path leads you.
Yeah, no, I completely agree. It's like, you want to start a business, you know, and you don't know how to start. You know, one of our business, you know, our board members talks about how you can literally go and sell a product without having a product. You could go and pitch an idea to businesses and say, would you buy this? Mm-hmm. Come up with a prototype, come up with the idea, have clear message. And you can literally say, hey, would you buy this? Okay, sign here, whatever it may be. And you can formulate a business out of that. So it's like, you can always choose to do something right now. You really can. And it's like that empowering. Sometimes people just don't know what to do tactically. Mm-hmm. I know I struggle with that. I have like a vision but I just don't know what to do specifically. What action's next? Mm-hmm. And that's where mentors come in. That's where Jason has come in my life.
Sure.
Jason Peterson, he's awesome. Business coach, board member, kind of our CTO right now at Opt. You just need to surround yourself. And the best way to find those people is honestly to get out there, out in public, in social events, at Silicon Slopes, at, you know, and just introduce yourself.
Yeah.
Mentors, I can't say enough about that. I think
that's cool. And, you know, Jason's obviously a major mentor to me. One of the lines that he says often that has really resonated with me is he says, a good entrepreneur, and I think you could say this for just a good person in life, like someone that's trying to go accomplish a dream or a passion. He said, a good entrepreneur has their head in their A good entrepreneur has their head in the clouds and both feet firmly on the ground at the same time. And it's like, I remember thinking about that. I'm like, there's always that balance, right? Of being the visionary, of thinking big, of going out there, but also knowing like, what is the next step? Yeah. What can I do today to help me get closer to that vision? And, you know, again, I go back to this theme over and over again on the podcast of being in the middle. Like, so much about life is finding the balance.
Yeah.
If you live in the extremes of your head in the clouds always, but never actually do anything about it, we all know someone like that. They're the talkers, right? Yeah. But if you can never think big and all you're focused on is just what's right in front of you, then you're going to do that for years and years and years, and it, you know, life catches up to you and you go, that didn't happen. And so, again, I think it's such a good place to find that balance and then go out and execute and make it happen and empower along the way.
Yeah. Yeah. What does that balance look like to you? Because that's something that I struggle with, and I think we look to millennials. Gen Z look to millennials because they're trying to figure out that balance. What does that look like to you?
Yeah, I think it's a balance of, first off, it's belief, right? Like the head in the clouds thing, I think, is what you mentioned earlier of like, we also know that you can succeed out there, right? Like you said earlier in this podcast, when I become a multimillionaire, it wasn't if, right?
Yeah.
It was like, you know that is an opportunity, that's a potential out there. So I think like always having that belief of, hey, this not only can happen, but it's going to happen. Like I can make that work, right? Now, what necessarily it is or how that might look might change. That vision might change. But then the other piece is understanding, I think, what's the next step. Mm. And so one thing that I had always said, you know, as I thought about my, you know, I said as a kid, I want to be a motivational speaker when I grew up, right? Like that was my vision. I want to be in front of all these people doing this. I don't even think I knew what a motivational speaker was at 12 years old, but that's what I said. And to me, it was like, I have this fuzzy idea of where I'd like to eventually go, but I can't stress myself and worry about the fact that I can't tell you the exact formula to get there. I don't know what it is. So to me, to answer your question, how do you find the balance? Always feel like you know what the next step is. If you don't feel like you know what your next step is, then you're lost, right? You don't need to know the next 3 to 4 steps. What are you doing right now? And as you then go do that continually, the next step will appear. And so I think that to me is where the balance comes from. If you can have that general idea where you want to go and then be confident about the actions you're taking right now.
Who or what, for me and for fellow Gen Zers, how do you determine what the next step is? I know that's a hard, hard question. Who do we go to?
Yeah.
How do we find that?
Really good question. I love, this is Hunter for you, right? I'm like, this is my show, Hunter. I ask the questions. Don't put me in the hot seat. No, I love it. Like, that's what it is. All of a sudden, what you just showed there is what we talked about in this episode that you want to learn, right?
And so, that's the thing. I'm being selfish as hell. Like, I'm just like, I'm a leech of knowledge. Like, I just want to grab, suck, and be like, peace out, bro. You know what I mean? Might get picked off every once in a while, but yeah. Hey, it's worth it.
So let's, okay, we had to take that side note yeah. to, like, give you kudos for being willing to learn.
I appreciate that.
But how do you figure out what that next step is? I think one of the phrases I've used quite a bit is trust your gut and put in the work. And I think you can, if you feel unsettled with what you're doing right there, it just doesn't feel like it's clicking. Like, it's probably not, right? Okay. Like, I think there's a sense of confidence that comes from when you are taking that right step right then. And if you feel, you know, we might not be positive that it's the right thing, but if you feel unsure or uncertain that what you're doing right now is at least good thing,
yeah,
then reevaluate, then think through it, right? So trust your gut, but then actually go and do it, right? So, we've talked about, you said starting a podcast. I had the idea to start a podcast, and that was a gut vibe. And like the whole millennial in the middle concept, it was one of those that it was just like, was given to me almost like, oh, this is it. And clowns to the left of me, jokers to the right, stuck in the middle with you. Like, boom, it just clicked.
Yeah.
And I could have sat and thought about, well, how am I going to do it? And, oh, what are people going to say? And all these different things. And a lot of people tell you when you start a podcast, you should have 5 to 10 recorded before you release so you can put them out in a batch. I recorded one on a Sunday afternoon, and I released it that night. Like, I just...
Out of excitement out or there. Just no, like...
I was just like, let's see where this goes. So yeah. I just did it. And all of a sudden, the feedback that I then got in that first episode was like, oh, I'm onto something here. And guess what? That motivated me to go do episode 2 the next day, right? And then to start reaching out to some people that I could interview and be like, man, this has evolved so much over the last 2.5 years, but that's life. And as people have asked me, like, oh, are you going to change your podcast name? Are you going to rebrand? Because now you're kind of making it a little more broad and talking about different stuff. You started about with politics in 2020. And I'm like, no, that's my story.
Yeah.
Why would I be like, well, I'm in a different place now, so I need to erase what I did 2 years ago? No, like, that's life. We build, we figure it out along the way. And I couldn't tell you what this would look like 2.5 years ago, but now, like, all right, now this is kind of cool as I'm saying this. Like, we're sitting in a 7,000 square foot space that has been, that all of a sudden the dream came about to, like, create this for creators and thought leaders and subject matter experts to come in and build content that's going to help empower, that's going to help people learn. And, like, that started from a podcast recorded in my parents' house on a Sunday afternoon.
Yeah.
And so to find the balance, just go for it. Trust your gut. Put in the work.
That's awesome. I love that. Yeah. I'm just thinking of, like, when I wanted to start a podcast.
Yeah.
Like, I could go start buying shiz like that because I already know all the systems.
Yeah.
I know how I'm going to, you know, distribute and everything. Yeah. I could have went and bought a microphone and a headset and started recording right then and there.
Yeah.
That's what I could have done.
Mm-hmm.
And if I felt like, no, there's something I'm missing, I need to research something.
Mm-hmm.
How do you not talk yourself out of it though? Because fear oftentimes will get in the way, especially for Gen Z, like my brothers, you know, all that stuff. That's just like this fear, this where, like, you don't know and you're unsure and there's this fear talking and it's always like in the back of your mind. How do you determine, like, whether right or wrong?
I love that question. Well, first off, I'll ask you this. I gave you a reading assignment when I hired you at Opt, and I handed you a book. I wrote a note in it, and I said, this changed my life more than anything else. I hope it helps you. What was that book?
The Untethered Soul.
Yeah, it was The Untethered Soul by Michael Singer. I've talked about it a lot.
Yeah.
But to me, the reason I'd say that is that's when it clicked for me that we have this internal voice, this neurotic inner roommate, nonstop going on in our heads, right? And there's a realization of, one, it's there. Two, it's not me.
Hmm.
Right? Like, the fact that I can say I'm hearing those thoughts, or I'm experiencing those emotions, or I'm having these experiences, shows that the thoughts aren't me. right?
Wow.
The thoughts is just this monkey mind that goes all day long, and all we're trying to do is just be okay in there, right? So for me, if you can recognize that you can start to listen to that internal chatter, and then you realize that a lot of it you don't need to pay attention to, that a calm mind is your best mind. And so I think, you know, meditation has become a big part of my routine. And the main teaching about meditation that a lot of people say is just being able to recognize that you are having thoughts in there. And
interesting.
From a seat of observation, not judgment, just going, there's a thought. I'm going to watch that come in and I'm going to let it go. And there are, I mean, thousands of thoughts that go through our head a day that don't serve us at all.
Yeah, I agree.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So that'd be awesome. My thought.
That's really powerful. It's like, you're always going to have that no matter what.
Yeah.
Just start freaking doing it.
Yeah.
And when something, you know, all because something goes wrong, still doesn't mean that it's the wrong thing. It's more of like a lack of clarity.
Yeah.
From what I understand, from what you're explaining, that's where, you know, you can kind of determine.
Yeah. I'm taking the hot seat back.
Okay.
I'm asking the final question that we're going to be done. No, I love it. No, it was real. Real conversations here. And I think, you know, as the show evolves, we've talked about, you know, I want to start having like some panel conversations. Where
That would be dope.
We have people from younger generations and older generations. And, you know, I can be like that generational middleman, right? Yeah. The millennial middleman, like bringing people together. That's really my goal with this. So awesome. I think this is a great test of like, this isn't me just being an interview. These are two-way conversations, people trying to create understanding. Let me ask you this in closing. We've talked a lot about Gen Z and how they feel about everybody else. I'm curious, how do you feel Gen Z views themselves? And what do you think are the defining characteristics of your up-and-coming generation?
I do think we have a lot of pride, almost like we're doing stuff better.
Mm-hmm.
And I think rightfully so. I mean, we have the best parents. You know, you see parents who are standing up for their kids. That would have never happened in the 30s. You know what I mean? Like, you don't see that often. You have the best trainers in the world, and you see these student athletes and these kid athletes, and you're like, holy frick, he could just dunk on me right now. And he's in seventh grade. They have the best trainers, the best people, and it shows a testament of evolving. And I think we are continuing to evolve. There's so much crap out there. There's people who are going to be like, bullshiz. Okay, cool. Like, this is not a factual, you know, podcast. This is, we're talking about it in our personal experiences. The reason I say that is because you'll see that we have this sense of entitlement.
Mm-hmm.
But it's also this sense of pressure. We have more pressure than any other generation. We have expectations that can't be fulfilled, and we're trying our best. I'm trying my best. But we've been given a playbook that doesn't work for the result that people are expecting. And that's what makes it hard. That's what I've had to learn. The hard lesson that I've had to learn.
Yeah.
Is that we have to make our own playbook. But I have no doubt in my mind that being vulnerable, you know, valuing freedom and choice, individuality, is going to benefit us.
Yeah.
When we're the leaders, when we're spiritual leaders, or when we are the leaders for politics or for these companies. Because we're going to understand, and we're going to have those authenticity sniffers and figure out what's really happening. One of the things that I think we lack, and Gen Z, like, seriously, listen. We lack self-discipline. We want to be instantly gratified because we can look up. I mean, the other day I was like, man, what's the name of that? And instead of thinking about it, because I know I could have, I looked it up.
Sure.
We've Googled cut it. Corners. Yeah, we Google it. We look it up on TikTok. Like, it's so easy to get instant gratification. And that makes it so we don't have as much discipline. And I would say to every single one of the Gen Zers who's listening, That's what you can learn from your grandparents and your parents. Sure, they might not be as woke. They might not be as aware. They might not be as funny. They might be way cringe. But they grew up in a different time where stability and safety was their goal. And so discipline had to be implemented. That's what I learned from my grandpa who passed away. And recently, we celebrated 10 years of him passing away and miss him. I mean, he left an entire life insurance policy that nobody knew about to my grandma because he was disciplined with his money. And the impact that that's had is like, I lack discipline and I recognize that. I need people around me and I need to learn how to do that. I think once we can learn how to do that, that's what's going to lock this generation.
Yeah,
it really will. Once you have that combination of vulnerability and like this really authentic generation that's just like, yeah, I am me. I'm who I am. Like, get over it. But then being able to be disciplined and listen to the systems and all of these things that we can learn from our previous generations.
Dude, that was a really thought-provoking and thoughtful answer. And I appreciate your ability to go within and think through this and critically think and try to be better, because I think that's at the core. Like, just trying to always be on the quest of self-improvement. And, you know, just to say as well, like, we are always, all of us, in the middle.
Yeah.
Like, we're never at a point where we can say we're at the end. We've figured it out. Now we tell everyone else, no matter your age, no matter what your experience is or how many wins or successes you have on your resume, you're in the middle trying to figure it out. And that's what all of us are trying to do along the way. So let's listen to each other.
Wow.
Let's try to connect and let's do all we can to understand each other. And as we do, I think we'll all be a lot happier and okay in there.
Wow.
Our internal voice won't be one that drags us down. It'll be one that's like, I got this. And you know what? People are awesome. Life is awesome. I'm excited for this day.
So powerful.
Yeah. I loved this interview. This was, it didn't necessarily go as I expected, and those are always the best episodes. So thanks so much for being willing to join the show. I'm sure we're going to have you back because I told Hunter that his job is to stay 6 steps ahead of me at all times.
Yes, sir.
And most times he's about 8 steps ahead of me, and that's just the way I want it. So you used the word cringe quite a bit today,
yeah.
Hunter.
Yeah.
Would it be cringe at the end of an episode to sing a song? Is that pretty cringe?
Yeah, but we'll...
Oh, okay. Yeah. I've done it 93 times now, so yeah. I'm not stopping the cringe now.
Okay. Yeah, just go with it then.
Clowns to the left me. Joke is to the right. Here I am, stuck in the middle with you. You're the man.
Hey, thanks, brother.
Let's go to the office.
Sounds bueno.
Thanks, everybody.
Clowns to the left of me. Jokers to the right. Here I am, stuck in the middle with you. Yes, I'm stuck in